Good morning, and welcome to Onalaska United Methodist Church. I am Polly Brown, one of the students in the OUMC SOAR group. We have a special service planned for you today because the SOAR students have entirely prepared and recorded this service for you. We hope you enjoy the service and follow along. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. Romans chapter 15, verse 7.
Okay, hi. This is the call to worship. So, yeah. Okay. Friends of God, believe this. God loved the world. God loves the world. We are beloved. May the truth of this great love story shine through our worship today and renew our sense of calling. So come with your tiredness, your frustrations, and your discouragements. Come with your doubts, your fears, and your longings. Come to discover yet again how Jesus reveals God's love and mercy. Come in friendship to God and to each other, and in friendships to the world. To listen for God's word to us, to offer our prayers, and to renew our calling. Friends of God, let us worship. Yee-yee. Our scripture this morning is from John 3, verses 14 through 21. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned. But whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. A response to the word for John 3, verses 14 through 17. At a time when humankind had exhausted its own efforts to know and be known by God, the word became flesh and lived among us. Jesus came to us, God with us, revealing God to us. Jesus remained with us for a time. In spite of our dull understanding and willful acts against God, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. He humbled himself and submitted to the humiliation of death on a cross. Jesus came to us as the ultimate expression of love.
If we were building something, which of these would we use to measure length, width, and height of different things? A watch, a measuring cup, or a tape measure? That's right, a tape measure. But I wonder if we might use a tape measure to measure God's love. The Bible tells us that God's love is higher than the heavens, Psalms chapter 108, verse 4. If God's love is higher than the heavens, I don't think we could use a tape measure to measure it. Could we? Which of these would I use to measure time? A measuring cup? A tape measure? Or a watch? We would use a watch to measure time. There will probably be some people here this morning who are using a watch to see how long the pastor's sermon will last. I wonder if we could use a watch to measure how long God's love will last. The Bible tells us that God's love is from everlasting to everlasting. Psalms chapter 103, verse 17. Wow, if God's love is from everlasting to everlasting, I guess we couldn't measure it with a watch.
For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. How do you measure love like that?
We can't measure it.
We don't need to, but we do need to experience it. My prayer for you today is that you may understand how wide, how long,
how high, and how deep his love really is.
May you experience it through it so great you will never fully understand it. Philippians 3:18-19.
Dear God,
thank you for your love, a love so great
that you
gave your one and only Son so that we could have eternal life. Name. Amen.
I have lots of stories from when I went to summer camp. There's a classic story where you need to go to the bathroom, but the house is far away from the cabin, it's already dark outside, so you have to go with some friends and a flashlight or two. The whole time you're thinking about how much you despise outhouses, whether or not that snap was from you stepping on a twig or something in the forest. Or that one where you and your friends are on boats, and you're trying to make them fall in the water. You're so close to getting one of them to fall in the water, but then you fall in instead. You know, classics. But one of my favorite parts of summer camp was this little alcove near the water. We'd go there every morning to sing and read scripture. There's big wooden steps for people to sit on, and you'd all watch the unlucky four or five people who had to make up and lead this group. But the unique thing about that little alcove were these old stone steps that probably used to lead onto a platform before the water level rose and covered most of them. So this whole time there was a sermon, all I was thinking about was where those steps led. Sure, I was listening, mostly, and I was singing along to all those camp songs, but I kept thinking about those old steps, wondering what they were there for. It wasn't until much later that I realized it was because they reminded me of faith. Of my faith, in particular. To me, faith is like water. It rises and falls, and there are people who are further in it than I am. And those steps reminded me of the path you take into your faith. You don't know the outcome, or if the path will even lead anywhere, but you can see the water flowing around your friends and family, and you can see it washing away their insecurities and smoothing down their faults, and you take that step further into the water anyway. I'm Anna Phillips. Thank you for listening to my God moment.
God of grace, we bring to you our ingratitude for all that you have done for us, our impatience. When prayers seem to be ignored, our selfishness. When prompted to give or share, our unfaithfulness. When wandering from your way, we ask for your forgiveness. Through Jesus Christ, who gave all, that we might learn to do likewise. Amen.
Hello, everyone. My name is Grace Johns. Today, I will be leading the sermon, so here goes nothing. No promises. The Bible passage that we will be reading from today is John chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. And it states that God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. God cares and loves us so much that he gave his only Son to help us during our darkest times. John later states that whoever believes in him is not condemned, but those who do not believe stand condemned already because they have not believed. Condemnation. That's a pretty big word. I assume many of you have heard it at least once in your lifetimes, but do you actually know what it means? According to our English dictionary, condemnation is the expression of a very strong disapproval or censure. It is the action of condemning someone to a punishment or sentencing them to it. Sounds pretty awful, doesn't it? Before I actually knew what this word meant, I'd always associate it with being bad. And that's basically what it is. I had heard it before in works of Shakespeare, like, I have a brother who is condemned to die from Shakespeare's No Fear. Condemnation is a bad thing, and no one wants to be condemned. And God doesn't want to condemn you. He never wanted to in the first place. Throughout the entire Gospel of John, this central theme is divine logos, the word that was with God and that was God. This logos became human and lived amongst common men as Jesus of Nazareth. John says nothing of a magical birth that happened one night in a stable. He regards Jesus as this living human being who possessed actual flesh and blood, just like you and me. The purpose of this gospel, as stated by John himself, was to show that Jesus of Nazareth was Christ, the Son of God, and that believers in him may have eternal life. This is the living truth. And even though scriptures clearly state this, many still believe that God wants to make us feel bad and terrible or condemn us. I know quite a few people that say if they've even stepped into a church after being away for so long, that the entire church would come collapsing down. Or the people of the church wouldn't accept me, would they? They wouldn't allow me to come back to that same church that I had abandoned. This is not true, and I'm telling you it's not true. God loves all of us, and he cares for us all. Many fathers wouldn't even give one thought into sacrificing their own son or daughter just to save an entire planet, our world. But God did. He cares and wants you to love him back. But God also respects the fact that sometimes you just need a little bit of a break. You don't have to commit your every last breath to God. Whenever you can is perfectly fine for him. He cares for you and likes caring for you. That's why you're here. So if you ever feel like the world around you is collapsing, just remember that God is watching over you and caring for you every step of the way. He wants you to feel loved and for you to love him. I say that's a win-win for both parties. John ends off this passage by saying that whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that I may be plainly see what they have done has been done in the sight of God. This applies to everyone watching this video. Yes, that means you. Even if you've missed a prayer at mealtime, or if you haven't been up to date lately in your Bible study group, as long as you know that God is a good and loving God, you will see the light of truth that John speaks of. You will know that feeling of love from him, your God, and those that you choose to surround yourself with. They are a clear representation of God. They care for you, and they love you and they want you to feel loved, just like God does. Jesus versus condemnation. That's the main theme of this passage today. Jesus faced condemnation straight up in the face when he sacrificed himself for us to save us from the sins that we had committed in the past. He was the living proof that God cared for his people and hadn't given up on humanity yet. If you ever feel alone, or if you ever feel scared or frightened, know and trust in God, because you are not alone when he is on your side. Condemnation. That's the theme here. Jesus was not afraid to give his life up for you because you are important. And that's why we're still here today. God loves and cares for us all. I'll let you think on that. Amen.
It is now time for the prayers of the people. Prayers for Amanda and the health of her baby. Prayers for Jessica's cousin Mark and his family, who all have COVID. Mark is in the hospital and on oxygen, and prayers for healing. Prayers for Nathan, that he would receive support encouragement, peace, and love. A joy is that Paul's brother's family welcomed baby Lewis, who was born on Thursday. Prayers for Seth, who has shingles, and prayers for healing. Prayers for Tammy, who is struggling with cancer. Prayers for unity in our country. Prayers that the vaccine will get to everyone soon, and patience as we all continue to deal with COVID. Prayers for students and teachers as they are returning to full-time in-person school soon. And prayers of thanks for our youth and for them leading our service today. Even though we were not able to do live prayer requests this week, you can still text them in and they will be prayed over this week.
Let us pray. Great and generous God, our lives are surrounded by things that steal our lives, inflict and destroy us, focused on not on the things that would take life away, but would renew our lives, hope, love, compassion, and empathy. As the Israelites looked to a serpent on a pole for healing, we look to a Savior on a cross to be brought back to life. In that holy name, Jesus the Messiah, we pray. Amen. If you would like to generously give your offering to the church this morning, you may give electronically by visiting oumc.org or send your offering into the church office.
Every single line.
Thank you for joining us today. If you are visiting Onalaska United Methodist Church and would like to know more about our congregation and how we play on Jesus' team, you can contact the church office or get information from our website or Facebook page. If you would like to talk with Pastor Park or just need someone to pray with, you can contact the church office and they will be happy to meet with you. Before concluding our service, I have a few announcements. We would like to thank all of you who helped with the community dinner. We served over 150 hot meals to people in need. Also, this is your last chance to order butter braids. They are due tomorrow by March, or the orders are due tomorrow, March 15th. You still have time to order them. You can order them in person during script time tomorrow between 12 and 1, or you can stop in the church office tomorrow before 2:30. You can also order online by finding the link on our Facebook page or e-news. Jessica is reading bedtime stories and praying on Zoom at 7 p.m. tonight. If you would like to join in this opportunity, you may contact her and she will send you the link. Our next OUMC blood drive is coming up on March 29th. Our goal is to have 36 volunteers and we already have 25 signed up. That means we still need 11 more people to help us. To sign up, you may contact Lexi Nelson or the church office. As the COVID risk levels continue to drop and more people are vaccinated, we are planning to have in-person services, although they will be limited, on Monday, Thursday, April 1st of Holy Week, and on Sunday morning starting April 18th. We will continue to live stream the services to people who are still worried about coming back. This week, there are a few small group opportunities via Zoom. The Growing Through Disaster group meets tomorrow night, and Pastor Bruce is leading a Lenten study on Wednesdays at noon. Our two adult Bible classes meet on Sunday mornings at 9:45, and our book club is meeting tonight on a Zoom call. Contact the church office if you would like more information about joining these groups. And now we will have some more songs, a blessing, and we will go forth. Thank you.
God has a path for your feet to follow, a plan for your heart to discover, and a purpose for your life to fulfill. As you walk with Him, you will see the beauty and wisdom of His ways. Father, guide our steps in your purpose for us. Give us the wisdom you promise, so that every step we take fulfills your hopes for us, and the work of your kingdom in this time and place. Going forth this week to love and serve the Lord.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Paul Bratch. I'm the Director of Discipleship here at OUMC, and I have the pleasure of getting to work with these amazing young people that you've seen. And this wouldn't be a SOAR service unless we finished by singing the song Light the Fire. It's a tradition that has been going on for years. Every time we get together, we end the night by singing Light the Fire. We've done it in Puerto Rico, on Native American reservations, going down sledding hills, all sorts of places. And these days we get to do it virtually, which is not the easiest thing. I don't know if you have had the pleasure of trying to sing with other people on Zoom over the past year, but it's not easy and it does not sound beautiful. The timing gets off and all that, but we have a lot of fun doing it, and we wanted to share a bit of that with you this morning. So, without further ado, here's our group of SOAR students singing Light the Fire.
People to unmute so we can hear your beautiful voices.
Give me a second here until I get to the camera.
I'm going to be like 3 measures behind.
That's perfect. That's perfect.
All right. Tell us when, Mom.
Whenever you're ready.
Okay.
I stand to praise you.
That was the best I've heard. Beautiful.